All right, rolling.
Adam, can you hear me back there, Adams?
Yeah, no, I can hear you. Even I can hear you, deaf as I am.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you for being here. My name is Will. If you don't know me, I'm the president of the Champaign County Democrats. We have Bill Bianchi here. He is the program director.
Board member for
the Illinois Single Payer Coalition. We're going to have he's going to present a slideshow for us about Medicare for All. And then if there's questions after that, and after the strobe light effect, you can ask any questions you want. We do have to be out of here right at 8, so the library can clean up. But I don't think we should have too big of a problem.
No.
All right. Bill, the floor is yours if you want this mic. Please
okay. Hold that button. Tell me if I need a mic. Does somebody going to need the mic?
No.
No?
No.
Okay. Because I probably just dropped it. Well, thank you for inviting me down. I'm with the Illinois Single Payer Coalition, and we've been working for about the past 12 years to help bring about Medicare for All, to a national Medicare for All to the country. As you know, if you've been paying attention to the Democratic debates, presidential debates, healthcare and healthcare reform is probably going to be the single biggest issue. It certainly gets a lot of time, and so it's really behooves us to be knowledgeable about the most important change that is being recommended by two of the candidates. Unfortunately, there's a lot of misinformation being put out by some of the people who don't want to see it. So we've developed this program as an educational tool to spread the facts about single payer so that people can make up their mind. So without further ado, So what we're going to do is we're going to spend about 25 minutes on our current healthcare system, and then another 20 minutes on the our solution to the problems of the current healthcare system, and then we'll go into question and answer. And so our current healthcare, how are we going to evaluate a healthcare system? Well, you know, we've got three elements of evaluation. One is, how much does it cost? We all know about that. And then access, how do you get into it? And then what are the outcomes? What are the health outcomes of a healthcare system? And we're gonna look at all three of those and evaluate our current system with those. So we're gonna start with cost. And so a couple ways to measure cost. One is by comparing, and we wanna compare our costs to other countries. And so we're comparing it along the lines of the gross national product. How much money of our gross national product is being spent on healthcare compared to other countries? Gross national product being the total of goods and services that are produced in 1 year. And as you can see, the United States is the red line at the top. We're number one by far. We're spending about 17, this is as of 2016, I think, or 2015, we're spending about 17% of our gross national product on healthcare. Whereas mostly the other wealthy countries are somewhere in the 9, 10, and 11% range. So it's quite a bit more. Another measure of cost is per person or per capita. You take all of the value of all the goods and services, put it in one big pile, divide by the number of people. And that gives you a number that you can compare with other countries. And again, as you see, the United States is way above everybody else. And this is from 2016. The United States is almost at $10,000 per person, per capita, whereas the other countries, even Sweden, all the way through the UK, are somewhere between $4,000 and $6,000 per person. So there's quite a few huge gap. So why are the costs so much higher here? Well, for one thing, there is no mechanism in the United States system for controlling costs. And so the players are free to charge whatever they want, and if they can get, you know, what the market will bear, as they say. Two, there's a huge amount of administrative waste and complexity in our system that doesn't exist in systems of other countries. And three, we're unique in that we allow, or we're caught maybe, a huge amount of corporate control of the system. Literally, private companies can decide price, cost, and outcomes. So that's what happens. And now here are some examples of the kind of crazy pricing you get when there's no way to control costs. This is the price of a MRI of the lower back, I think it is. Something lower back with dye, D-Y-E, in the San Francisco area. Down at the bottom, you can see that, we have the Castro Valley open MRI, and it costs $4.75. And then we go up here to the NorCal imaging of Walnut Creek, which is a town in the San Francisco area, and they're charging $1,000 for that same procedure. Interesting enough, NorCal has another imaging over in Oakland, and they're charging $1,700. And then the California Pacific Medical Center charges $2,600, and finally the University of California, San Francisco, $6,200. So, do you think it's the same MRI? Is there something different about the $6,000 MRI that makes it much more expensive than the $400 MRI? Probably not. I'll cut them some slack that it's probably a teaching hospital and they have do a lot of good work and they need to charge extra. But that's a fantastic difference between $475 and $6,200. Here's another cost comparison, hospital cost per day. And this is an international comparison. The red bars show what the national average is for that country. So the national average for the United States is $5,220. And down at the other end for Spain, a day in the hospital only costs $424. Of course, they may not have single rooms, so that may be different. The black bar to the right shows what the average of the top 5% in this country is charging for a hospital day. And it's at $17,358. I mean, it's a huge, huge difference. And it's hard to conceive of how there could be such a spread in costs. Here's another similar type comparison, hospital physical for an appendectomy. Again, the red bars are the average cost for appendectomy in an American hospital, US hospital, around $16,000. And then we have the average cost in a bunch of other countries. Going down to South Africa, it's only $1,700. The black bar again is the top five, average of the top 5%, $33,000. So could you imagine if you didn't have any coverage, you walk out of there after your appendectomy, feeling a lot better, of course, but with a $33,000 bill to pay, and that's gonna make you feel a lot worse. It might even bring on something else, cause those stitches to burst. And then now we get everybody's favorite topic, drug prices. Here's a comparison between the prices in Canada versus the United States. Now Canada does have a single payer system, but strangely enough, it doesn't cover prescription drugs. So people in Canada have to get insurance for their drug coverage. And nevertheless, the prices in Canada for these somewhat well-known drugs are much lower. EpiPen, which you've heard, which I think is for something to do with breathing, right? When you have problems breathing and it clears them up.
Allergic response.
It's what?
Allergic.
Allergic, okay. So allergy. If you get allergies and the breathing is constricted, so you use that. And in Canada, 90-day supply is $250. In the United States, it'd be $637. So more than twice. Now here, down at the bottom, we have Celebrex, which is something I've used for my knees, which is arthritis. A 90-day supply in Canada is $254. In the United States, $1,100. So these are, you know, again, what causes this huge disparity in prices? No control. And the other thing is about drug prices are the arbitrary increases that come from change of ownership, mostly. Here's a drug called calcium EDT for lead poisoning. In 2013, it was $950. And then the company got bought out by, I don't know, who, corporate acquisition. And the new owners raised the price to $27,000. That's what you call smart business. And then looking at the one at the bottom, the leukemia, is really outrageous. It was $27,000. And then it rose in 16 years to $120,000. And I don't know for how long that, how much supply. Again, it was after an acquisition by another company. So there's no medical reason for this outrageous rise in cost. It has nothing to do with research. These new companies are not doing any research. They're just buying out the old company and jacking up the price to whatever they think they can get. So, why does it happen? Because there's nothing to stop it. Okay, let's look at another indicator of our healthcare system, the administrative waste and complexity. We have, as anybody over 35 years old has had to deal with our healthcare system knows, it's complex. You're never quite sure what you're going to get when you go to the hospital, or what kind of a bill you're going to get. You really have to make the claim and find, then you find out. And one of the main reasons for this is that we have a multi-payer system, not a single-payer system. We have all these different payers, all these different providers of health insurance. We have the employer-based system, where 150 million people in this country are pretty much covered to some extent or another by employer. But every company has little different plans, different networks, different costs. So, and then you have traditional Medicare, Medicare Advantage, which is the privatized Medicare, and there you have hundreds of plans, little different covers, little different deductibles. And then you have Medicare supplements. Again, I have a Medicare supplement, I have a traditional Medicare with a Medicare supplement. Everybody's pays a different amount, gets different coverage. We have Medicaid and managed, which is the for low-income people, and then managed care organizations, which are the privatized version of Medicaid. We have ACA Health Exchange or Obamacare. And if you've ever gone on those websites to look for an ACA, you know that it's pretty damn complex. It's hard to figure out, you know, what you should get, because it looks cheap, but then there's a problem over here, and then this is kind of expensive, but it's actually better cost. So anyway, and then we have the children's health insurance policy, student health plans, veteran health plans, TRICARE, which is for active duty military, and the Indian Health Services. So all of these are providing health insurance, but at different levels, different kinds. Imagine if you are a doctor or a hospital and a patient comes in. You have no idea what you're going to be paid or how you're going to be paid because of all of this complexity. And so here's a diagram that kind of shows what our system looks like. It's a mess. So all of this creates an enormous amount of administrative overhead. And here's a comparison of the private costs. And by administrative overhead, we mean all those costs that don't go directly to healthcare. So, and we'll get into what they are in a minute. But I want to point out that under privatized Medicare, that is Medicare Advantage, the administrative cost is 19% of the total. Under the public Medicare, the administrative cost is less than 2%. So there's many billions of dollars going into non-medical costs. And let me just check something out. Okay. And the reason is, of course, that the private insurers have to design plans and figure out the benefit cost ratio so that there's some profit left over. And then they have to negotiate with doctors and hospitals over what they're going to be paid, so they can create the networks. And then they have to have people to talk about when they deny somebody and you call up because you're angry, there's got to be somebody at that end saying, you know, yelling back at you, so to speak. And all of this requires huge numbers of people, and that's what the administrative money goes to. In addition to that, it goes to the profits of the company, and those profits are used for such worthy things as paying dividends to investors, buying back their stock, and paying executives $20 million. It's an interesting comparison. The executive, top executive, CEO of, let's say, any one of the top healthcare insurers will probably receive in compensation 1 year close to $20 million. The chief executive of Medicare Medicaid Services, which manages Medicare and Medicaid for 125 million Americans, receives a salary of about $330,000. A tiny fraction of what the private CEOs are getting. Why? Because there's no way to control it. So, what we have then is, we also have these different levels of reimbursement, which incentivizes the system to treat the wealthy over average people. So different insurers reimburse at different levels. So if three of us went into a hospital and we all had the same problem and we got exactly the same treatment by the same doctors and the same nurses, the hospital would get different amounts of money depending on what kind of coverage you had. If you were a Medicaid patient, they'd get the lowest level of reimbursement and maybe not enough to keep their doors open. If you're a Medicare patient, they'd get a little better reimbursement. But if you were privately insured through your employer, they might get a much higher level of reimbursement. So therefore, hospitals try to optimize their payer mix, which means that they're going to look for ways to attract wealthier people with higher paying insurance. And so meanwhile, urban and rural hospitals are closing for lack of funds. And one of the main problems is that Medicaid, they have a higher proportion of Medicaid patients, and they're getting the least amount of money from that, and also a higher proportion of uninsured people, and so they're getting less money for that too. And so here are some of the hospitals that have had to change that. So they do two things. Some have to close, but some just move to a wealthier neighborhood so that they can attract wealthier clientele. So in Chicago, on the right there, Jackson Park Hospital, they're closing their maternity center because they can't afford to keep it open. Metro South in Blue Island is going to have to close, I think, at the end of this year, maybe at the end of November, because 40% of its patients were on Medicaid, and Medicaid reimbursements in Illinois were reduced by some formula recently, within the past 6 months, I think. I don't know why. Franciscan in Chicago Heights, which is a lower income suburb in Chicago, they moved 5 miles west to a wealthier suburb, Olympia Fields. I guess they're doing okay. Over here on the left, we had Kenneth Hall, East St. Louis, served the uninsured. They had 4 times the national average of uninsured patients, and they had to close. So you're seeing, and practically every month or so, you see about some merger of hospitals. And that's what's driving it, is this variation in reimbursement, this unequal reimbursement based on what kind of coverage you have, not based on your sickness or illness. So, the third category is access. How do we get into the darn system in the first place? Well, the U.S. still has 28 million people without insurance. This is as of 2017, I think. And I think it's up to 30 million now. So they have the hardest time getting access, obviously. But 28% of working age Americans are underinsured. And you've probably heard that term. And what we're, I think Kaiser, one of the research, defined underinsurance as a situation where 10% of the premiums and the deductibles in any 1 year would add up to at least 10% of your gross income. So if you're making $40,000 a year and your premiums and your deductibles add up to $4,000, then you're underinsured because it's a huge barrier. It makes you think, I better not go see the doctor because it's just going to cost me a lot of money and I don't have it. So the number of children without coverage has increased for the first time in 8 years. And these high out-of-pocket costs, as we mentioned, restrict, obviously you don't have to be, you know, a medical expert to figure out, if you don't have the money in the bank to pay a, even a few hundred dollar deductible, you're going to try to avoid going to the doctor. You're going to try to avoid taking expensive medication. Some more bad news. 60% of those following bankruptcies are saying the major problem was a healthcare cost. It's not that healthcare is the only thing that would drive a person to bankruptcy, but it tends to be the thing that is the tripwire. It's the last big bill, and that's the one they can't afford. 70% of those who have private insurance, of those who went into bankruptcy, did have private insurance, but they lost it because they were sick and were not unable to work. And then 50 or 7% of those who lost their homes to foreclosure identified medical debt as a major cause. This, by the way, makes the United States unique. In other countries, in fact, I have relatives in Italy, and I've asked them about medical bankruptcies, and I had to explain to them what I meant, because they didn't understand it. There's nothing like that here. And here's a slide that shows how premiums for employer-sponsored insurance have risen in the past 20 years. Back in 1999, you're paying about $5,700, $5,800 in total for family coverage. Now in 2018, that had risen to almost $20,000. And the dark blue is the employer's share, and the light blue is the employee's share. So when people talk about, you know, when politicians say, well, people don't want to give up their employer-sponsored insurance, are they sure about that? Because look what it's costing people today, $5,000-$6,000 a year to have employer-covered insurance. I know it's a hard one to see. So what happens with the high deductibles is people are simply deferring costs. And this chart is just showing you what percentage of people have said, people at ages 19 to 64, reported any of the following cost-related access problems. They've said that they have a medical problem, but they did not visit a doctor or clinic. They did not fill a prescription. They skipped a recommended test, treatment, or follow-up. Well, and or they did not get specialist care. And you can see that 2003 to 2018, it's somewhere in the mid-30s to the low 40s. Our people are refusing or unable, probably financially, making a decision that they're going to save the money or they don't have the money. And then there's the what we call the ultimate sacrifice, the number of people who are dying needlessly due to lack of insurance. And you can see the correlation between uninsured and deaths, what they call excess deaths. Texas has the highest number of uninsured in the nation at 17%. And it has 6,200 people who have died in excess deaths. California has one of the lower uninsured rates of 7%. And even though it has a much higher population, its excess deaths were down to 3,600. So I think that points out how just having insurance, having some kind of coverage, is really vital to maintaining good health. Here in Illinois, I was surprised to learn that about 20-some percent of the people in Illinois are on Medicaid. I didn't know that. It's like 3 million people. And so it's not surprising that about 23% of our state budget goes to Medicaid. Starting in 2011, to save more money, the state has moved to privatize Medicaid. And this has largely been done. Before, the state would pay a doctor or hospital directly, and there'd be very little bureaucracy in between. I don't know how promptly they paid. But now they're in something called managed care organizations. Everybody on Medicaid has to be, or I think it's like 80-some percent now, has to be in a managed care organization, which is an organization run by a private insurance company. And how do they make their money? Well, they're given a set fee annually for every person that they enroll, regardless of whether the person gets sick or not. So then the managed care organization goes to the doctors and negotiates with them the lowest possible reimbursement rate, and the same thing with the hospitals. And as a result, they have very narrow networks. And they have a great deal of difficulty finding specialists, particularly in rural areas, where, you know, where people can, because the specialist won't work for the little bit of money that they're being offered by the managed care organization. So, in summary, the taxpayers' money is funding private profits while patients are getting subpar care. I do want to stress that Medicaid is still better than nothing, right? And Obamacare did, probably the best thing it did, is to extend Medicaid to millions of people who didn't currently have it, including one of my good friends. Okay. So, outcomes. In other words, how healthy are we as a result of our healthcare system? Now, you would think, with all the money that we spend, you would expect that we would have among the best health outcomes. And, in fact, we don't. Our rankings compare, the first one is preventable deaths due to treatable conditions. Out of 19 wealthy countries, we are 19th. So think about that. It's preventable deaths that could be prevented by the proper treatment. We're 19th. Mortality that could be prevented by good medical care, we're 35th out of all nations. And in life expectancy, we're 25th out of all nations. Compared to Western Europe and Japan and I think Taiwan, you know, most of those countries, are their life expectancy is in the low 80s, you know, maybe even as high as 85, whereas I think ours is somewhere around 78, 79, and it's going down due to a lot of different things. Okay, so probably the hallmark of a country's medical care system is maternal mortality. And the idea is to have it as low as possible, right? But here's a chart that shows maternal mortality from 1990 to 2015. As you can see, once again, we're number one, but we're the only wealthy country where maternal mortality has risen substantially in the past 25 years, something like that? Whereas all the other wealthy countries, it's gone down. But not only in the wealthy countries, in most of the non-wealthy countries, it's gone down. Right now, our death rate in maternal mortality, that means women who are dying in childbirth or directly as a result of childbirth, I don't know if it includes the children dying too, but we're on a par with Iran and Vietnam. So we're spending enormous amounts of money, but obviously most of that care is going to the top. I just thought it was interesting that even the UK has a particularly high, but anyway. Well, there are other forms of inequalities in the healthcare system. We just thought we would mention it, and they have to do with income and racial inequalities and structural factors that cause great variations in healthcare outcomes. And in Chicago, you know, neighborhoods vary not only by their location, they vary enormously by class. And so when you're near the lake, and this green line represents the green line train, which runs through the, you know, the heart of the Chicago area. And if you're downtown by the Loop, the average lifespan, I don't know how they calculate this, is 85. And then if you move west to East Garfield Park, it falls to 72, West Garfield Park to 69, and then when you get that out to Oak Park, it's up to 81. Now there are a lot of different factors that play in this. It's not just healthcare alone, but healthcare is definitely one of them. So, how do we measure up? How is our healthcare system measuring up in terms of costs? You know, there's supposed to be a little, there they are. Well, it's appalling how expensive it is. It's just crazy, really. Access, it's sad that people could be living next door to a great university hospital center and not be able to use it because they don't have the right kind of coverage. And it's not all, by the way, it's not all about wealth. I mean, you could work for a union and they have good coverage, right? the guy next door doesn't work for a union and doesn't have good coverage, or people who kind of work for themselves, I don't know what they do. They're really struggling. And then out comes, well, it's just sad. It's just sad. Okay, and this last one shows the performance of the healthcare system performance compared to spending. So the higher you go, the better the healthcare outcome, and the farther to the right you go, the more expensive it is. So you can see some other wealthy countries, they're doing very well in terms of their healthcare performance, and the United, and they're in the middle. They're all about lumped in about the middle in terms of cost. The United States is the outlier, way out here. Most expensive by far, and not very good in terms of outcomes. So we've got these problems. What is our solution, we suggest, is single payer or improved Medicare for all. And we use the words interchangeably. Some people don't like single payer because they don't know what it means, and other people say we shouldn't call it, well, anyway. So, what is single payer? What is improved Medicare for all? First of all, it covers everybody from birth to death. So, you're no longer tied to a job, marital status, age, or income, or geography for that matter. You're covered, period. And this is a concept that is hard for people to understand in the United States, although very easy outside of the United States. Wait, I went too fast there. You have comprehensive coverage, including payments to medical, preventive care, dental, vision, hearing, long-term care, prescriptions, mental health, and reproductive care. And this is, in other words, every medical necessity is covered. And so, you don't need all those plans. You don't need the marketing that, I don't know if you're, those of you who are 65, you get bombarded with stuff about Medicare Advantage, right? It comes like every day. I'd like to heat my house with that stuff, make a nice fire. There's no cost sharing, and this is very important. No co-payments, no premiums, no deductibles, no barriers to going to see the doctor. And it's paid for by one national payer, which will probably be the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services. But the care is still provided by private institutions and doctors in private practice. So why do we say improve Medicare for all? Well, because the current Medicare has some problems. For one thing, it doesn't cover enough. It doesn't cover vision, dental, pharmaceuticals, and long-term care. I know everybody in this room is probably at some point going to need some long-term care. And we should be, the only thing available right now is through Medicaid. And in order to get long-term care through Medicaid, you have to be impoverished, right? You have to give up. Like every dime you have, it's like $2,000. That's a pathetic amount. And why are we doing this to people? When it comes to the military or something like that, man, it's like the money flows. But okay. So, and then there's no need for supplemental private insurance, so you don't have to worry about that anymore. So how is it going to work? Okay, here's you on the left. You get a cold or something, your lungs are feeling bad, you're sneezing, you go see the doctor. You see any doctor that will see you, any doctor of your choice. There are no more networks anymore. The doctor examines you, doesn't have to call the insurance company to see if this is covered. Everything's covered, so all of that bureaucracy that dealt with what's covered and what's not is gone. Gives you the treatment that he thinks you need, prescribes drugs for you, you go to the pharmacy, get the drugs you need, there's no question about cost. The Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services pays the doctor, according to the bill that we have, in 2 to 4 weeks. One of the big problems with the private insurers is they wait, they hold back payment for a month, 2 months, 3 months. And hopefully you're feeling better, the doctor's feeling a lot better because he or she got paid. And here's the important thing, the doctor gets paid the same amount for everybody. It doesn't matter whether you're rich or poor, young or old, or black or white, or whatever, they get paid the same amount. So they can, with good conscience, spend the same amount of time with everybody. Might still be a bad doctor, but nevertheless. So just to remind you what we have now, it's a mess. Okay. So, benefits of single payer: increased efficiency, reduced waste. We get rid of, you know, one of the things I was going to say that I forgot to say later was a statistic that was really important, that some hospitals now have more people in their billing department than they do nurses on the floor. And this is crazy. Under a single payer system, there'll be something called global budgets. Instead of charging for every little thing that they do, they don't charge anything. They get a budget from the government that lasts them for a period of time. You don't have to worry about paying for anything. But it does mean that a lot of people who are involved in the billing will not be having a job, that they can go into healthcare. And there's money to train them. So it's under single payer, there'll be negotiations will be much more effective. Doctors will negotiate with Medicaid, Medicare services, hospitals will negotiate, and there'll be one negotiation for the entire country. So if an appendectomy is $3,000 in California, it'll be $3,000 in New York, in Florida, in Oklahoma. So everybody will know, all doctors and hospitals will know what they're going to get paid up front. The government will be more accountable. Governments often aren't too accountable, but it'll be a lot easier to figure out what's going on than it is now under the private system, where we have no idea at all what's going on. Improve financial stability of hospitals in rural areas or in low-income neighborhoods, because they're getting the same amount of money for treating their patients as Northwestern and University of Chicago is for treating their patients. The care will be more equitable for reasons I just mentioned. And I think there'll be a whole lot of reduced stress on people. It's just one thing we can't quantify too well is the amount of stress that people face. My brother recently got unexpectedly a bill for $54,000 for his wife's treatment for his wife's condition, which he thought was covered by the insurance company, and found out due to some technicalities about her, the new employer, she wasn't covered,